Hello, I'm Kevin Clarkin, Vice President at Anderson Group Marketing and Advertising, and I'm pleased to be here today with Jack Williams, the Executive Director of the Berks Coalition to End Homelessness. Hi, Jack, how are you?
Hi, Kevin.
Now, the agency had the pleasure to work with BCEH just recently, and it was a real eye-opening experience for all of us involved to learn just about the problem and what it is that the coalition does, and I'm really excited to be here today to tell the community what you had told us and just explain all the different aspects of the problem and what it is that you do to help correct it. So I'm going to start with a real general question and really just, could you define what is homelessness?
So homelessness really basically has two different definitions. The federal government defines homelessness as anybody not living in a suitable habitat or living not in a home, but in anywhere outside of a home, in a car, in a parking lot, on the street corner. And that's a definition of homelessness. And obviously there could be chronic homelessness or whatever what's causing that situation at this very moment. And then the Department of Education adds to that for any youth homelessness, anybody that's couch surfing. So,
and what is couch surfing?
Couch surfing is typically, but not only reserved for youth. But think of a student that's homeless and might be living with a friend,
okay.
and at that home that they're living in at that time, there might not be a bedroom suitable for an additional teenager or youth, so they're living on a couch, and it's a very temporary situation. There's no legal guardianship of that individual, that youth. So you combine those two definitions, and you would love to have the government agree on those two, but so for different funding streams, one applies and one does not apply, because HUD does not consider if you're living in someone else's house and living on their couch, they don't consider that a homeless situation occurrence.
Okay, so that's a broad overview of what's the problem. Tell me about who is really affected. And one line you said to me was, it's just about everywhere and it can happen to anyone. And that really struck me because I believe people have this stereotype of what you think homelessness is, but it's really not what the general person thinks.
Yeah, because the stereotype is, just as I thought before I became involved with the coalition and became the executive director, you know, my premonition was, or predisposition, better word, is that person on the street corner, typically male, typically older, typically looking for a handout, or the look that you normally have in your mind's eye. Well, that's so different and so from what reality. And the reality is, why it's everywhere, it's because it's every portion of the population, every time interval, youth. There are homeless college students that can't afford, they can afford, or they get their loans, they pay out to pay for their academic portion of it, but can't pay for housing or can't pay for a meal ticket. And then you got families that are experiencing homelessness coming in either out of a rental situation or reuniting maybe even after incarceration. All the way up to you've got homeless elderly that in a situation where they might have been living on a fixed income, there's two Social Security payments, and those two, just two combined Social Security payments are able to meet the monthly rent. One of them passes, it's now reduced, and that one Social Security system alone can't pay the rent plus whatever other, you know, monthly bills, including utilities. So it's so difficult to put your finger on one single subset of the population because it really crosses every single one of them, and they ebb and they flow. Unfortunately, overall, it increases.
Right, and this Berks County, I mean, Berks County is not protected from this problem, is it?
No, there's nothing. This is a nationwide problem. It just so happens that we're, you know, we live and we operate in Berks County, and it's no different. We, you know, we've got the city of Reading with a fairly high rate, close to the lowest income that you can have and still survive and to afford an apartment. So we're not insulated from any of it. There's some urban myths about the city of Reading and Berks County, one of them being that it almost attracts homeless population. There's nothing that we can provide proof that doesn't happen. We highly suggest that it's not happening. It's just that when you see it and you experiencing it here, you think that maybe there's extra services that could possibly serve as an attractant, and we don't really believe that's true. It's just that the rate of homelessness increases.
Okay.
Has been increasing.
And this was something that I was not expecting to hear, but you had said that there are homeless camps within the city. And I thought people just do not expect that. Not here.
There are homeless camps. They kind of move. They're obviously in areas where the tents, They find a place where they don't feel they're being very obvious, so authorities can't shush them along, or that they're somewhat protected by the environment under bridges or in outside or maybe aligning to a park situation. But we have a street outreach team. We're aware of them. We get reports on them. We constantly connect with them. So oftentimes, we'll find that if there is someone there, we'll try to get them into a shelter if they're so willing. We can't force them into a shelter. Some of them haven't lived in shelters prior, and that's a subsegment of the population that doesn't do well in a congregate setting. Like you picture a shelter with many, many cots. They've tried it and they don't do well. And those individuals, for whatever reason, choose to live in the outdoors, live by themselves in a situation that they think they've got more control and don't have to abide by the rules and regulations and of what a shelter living is like. So we'll oftentimes show up at an encampment, and you can see the remnants of the camp, or the camp might have moved. And then 2 months later, the camp reinvents itself, and so it is there, and we've had them in all portions of Berks County. We've had them in Morgantown, we've had them in Birdsboro. We've had them in Boyertown, and obviously we've had them in the city of Reading.
So is the problem getting worse now since with COVID, the economy, so many different factors coming in? Is homelessness on the rise?
It's our belief that the pandemic was the worst possible storm for those marginalized individuals, because they got affected the most. They were the ones that were, you know, obviously, for a cliche, living paycheck to paycheck, but the service industry, the hospitality industry, restaurants, hotels, those that lost their jobs and couldn't collect unemployment because their wages or their employment records didn't suffice to qualify for unemployment. Living in the city of Reading and renting an apartment, that apartments increased, I think, 22% in the last year and a half, mainly because of the pandemic. So they faced all the situations, and then they faced it. You know, they faced inflation costs for their food or for their groceries, for their gas, for their utilities. So it was the worst possible storm.
Right.
And things weren't going great to begin with prior to the pandemic. It just got worse. So I'm not a soothsayer. I can't tell you what it's going to look like in 10 years, what the long-term effects of the pandemic were, and how they affected that subsegment of the population. But my feelings are it's going to be dramatic, and it's going to be negative.
Okay. There was a statistic that you had told me that was just mind-numbing was this. You said 76% of the people are experiencing homelessness for the first time due to lack of affordable housing. And that is, again, breaking the stereotype
Correct.
Of what you consider homelessness is. And this is a phenomenon that you said is running rampant. And can you explain a little bit about that, how this is happening and what's causing the problem?
Correct. It's a nationwide problem. And the statistics, it's about, let's just use 75% because it goes up and down, or it's been up and down, but 22 to 23, those experiencing homelessness were 75% and were experiencing it for the first time. Typically, that's someone, you can relate to this very easily, that someone being evicted from an apartment, right? And they, for whatever reason, they weren't able to keep up with that rent. The landlord takes them, puts them through the eviction process. There was assistance from the Emergency Rental Assistance Program, which is COVID funding that helped Berks County dramatically, but it didn't help everyone. And that day when the constable shows up and says, you know what, you've gone through the eviction process with the courts, we're granting possession back to the landlord who has every legal right to that property, and you have an hour to gather up your belongings if you haven't already left, if you haven't already reacted to knowing that what that date and time was going to be, and you load up and you've left. Now, oftentimes you've got depending on the individual situation of that family. If you've got another family member you can go live with, if you've got some relatives or friends that are willing to allow you to move in with them temporarily. But what if you don't? You don't have family in the area, or if you might have burned some of those bridges already, and then you've got no place to go, and now all of a sudden we've got a typically family situation that's never been homeless before. And that's the big impact in those numbers and it's typically economics, mm-hmm. right? Whether they can afford that rent, whether for instance, there's been a rise in properties in the city of Reading where landlords had rental units. They decided to cash in because of a rising real estate market and say that this is no longer going to be a rental. We're going to sell it off to an individual that's going to live here and not continue as a rental. Well, that just continues to affect that same exact situation, not only the economics, but the real estate market and all the other impacts that go along with the social economic marketplace.
But that, to me, to hear that homelessness can happen while your husband or people in the household are working, but they can't afford the rent, I don't think people think that at all or realize what a problem that really is.
It's just affordable housing, the lack of affordable housing. So, you know, there are public housing units in and around the city of Reading and in Berks County, just not enough of them. There's the properties that are being built or being maintained as large complexes aren't necessarily meant for this subsegment of the population. They can't afford them. You know, we're talking about a living wage, right? And that would dramatically help people what they can afford and afford a little bit more of a rent. But the units have to be there. So this is a nationwide problem where we don't have the housing stock. And it's not something, unfortunately, that you can just, you know, the government or city officials, county officials, federal officials can't just snap their fingers and create these units overnight. It's got to be intentional. These are much, much bigger budget items to agree on. If the government can find and target an area to build more affordable units, where does it go? Is it going to go in your backyard? Is it going to go in my backyard? So NIMBYism, not in my backyard, has a big hurdle to jump over for federal and government officials to put more housing stock. So, and this is not going away easily. This is a long-term problem. That's been existing, and it continues to exist. Some areas were able to capitalize on some of the funding during the COVID and COVID relief and from the federal and buy units buy or because, mainly because they already had some of the agreements already in place, so they were able to say, listen, like we can use that funding for properties that we own, land that we own, we could renovate and then create some more housing stock. We weren't in that situation, and so we weren't able to capitalize during COVID funding in that area.
Okay, so this is very interesting. Like, you've identified that lack of affordable housing, rent increases, going people's wages not being able to keep up with that. What are some of the other causes of homelessness? Because no, it just can't be isolated to one. I'm sure there are many other reasons.
Well, what you really have to look at is there's so many different contributing factors. You know, there's childhood trauma, right? Drug and alcohol. Did the trauma come first? Did the drug and alcohol addiction problems follow the trauma? You're looking at generational poverty. You know, what family generation is going to break that chain of low income, right? And I don't mean to oversimplify this or to minimize the effects of any of these things, because each individual has one, two, three, four of these factors going to them, going against them. And we just did a study. We're doing a training on our team at the coalition, and our first study was 201 homelessness from an individual that runs a homeless shelter in Chicago, and a recent study has proven that 12% of homeless people have experienced trauma in some way that the general population has not, so as compared to 1%. So we're constantly at the coalition trying to learn, trying to advocate, trying to be at that umbrella situation where we're an umbrella organization, when we are not a shelter. So we're trying to make sure that we push, ask, request, educate, try to do the best we possibly can with the resources that we're given to try to fight homelessness on such a varied level.
Okay. Well, this, I mean, understanding that you had also talked about homelessness can come from leaving a dangerous situation, an abusive partner or spouse, or substance abuse or mental health. So everything we've talked about has surely explained what a problem we have here, that homelessness is bigger than people realize. It's more impactful than people realize. It can happen to just about anybody. And that's where I think you can explain where the Berks Coalition to End Homelessness, where that comes in, because I think just from the name alone, people immediately feel, well, it's a shelter. Mm-hmm. This is where you're going to bring in people looking for housing for the night or short term. But it was just so eye-opening to us to learn what it is that you do and the great staff that you have. What is it? Explain to the community, please, what it is that you do.
So what the federal government says that they need boots on the ground. So in every county in the United States, there's an organization like the Coalition that's given that responsibility for the federal dollars coming from Washington, D.C. that are going to come locally, and in our case, into Berks County. And it's one of two organizations traditionally. It's either standalone 501c3 corp, which is what we are here in Berks County, for the Berks Coalition to End Homelessness, or it can be an office in the county government seat. So, and what the government then asks you to do is that the money that's coming through and to fight homelessness, that someone sits in that oversight position, right? And because every county is different, every makeup is different, every population is different. The one area might have very, very good transitional housing, where one does not have any permanent housing, where another area doesn't have enough shelters. So they ask you every year to do the application, to look at those organizations that get funded through the HUD, the federal dollars, and to say, are they doing what they're supposed to do? Are they doing it to the standards that the rules and regs say they're going to do? And what areas are not being missed? Where are the areas that are, where are the holes in the safety network that you should be addressing, locally? In addition to the annual application, which is basically a competition for homeless dollars, they ask you to keep the data. So, and the data is the lifeblood of what's going on, what's trending. Like if we see a jump in this area of population, why did that? And because it didn't happen anywhere else in the United States, then we can say, well, there was a specific occurrence that or some factor that created that jump, or does that trend go nationally? So they ask you to do the data, they ask you to do the annual application, and then they ask you to run what's called coordinated entry. And coordinated entry is very simply trying to level the playing field for homelessness. So if you and I both show up homeless today, and we call 211 and we say, we're, you know, Kevin's homeless, Jack's homeless. Instead of allowing happenstance to figure out who gets services, or who might get shelter, or who might get transitional or permanent supportive housing, they ask the coalition or the organization that they place that responsibility with to do a review and a scoring tool and say, you've been homeless for longer, you've been homeless for more occasions than I've been homeless, and that you should get the resources first. And it's a difficult thing to do because it's an animal that constantly moves, changes,
sure.
And you're working with all the different organizations that could possibly place the both of us into a program. It's basically designed to take the happenstance away from it, so to try to make sure that those that are the most vulnerable get the services. And then once you're able to do that, once the government says you performing that to a reasonable level of competency, then you can do other things. But what they don't want you to be is they don't want you to be tremendously in direct services, because they feel direct services will then take you away from looking at this in a global view, that you can't be looking at everything as a Berks County thing or as a Berks County causes and effects, right? If you're dealing with that individual homeless person, it's going to take away from your insight, your experience level, your advocacy time and so. But many people don't understand that. It's not the simplest thing to explain,
sure,
to someone that's not familiar with the coalition.
But you're helping the other resources.
Correct.
For people in the community.
Correct.
See, that's
right.
That's, I think, what people do not understand is you're a great resource center to help all the other shelters or other services like Salvation Army or Hope Rescue Mission.
Or Opportunity House, or Safe Berks, or organizations. It's not just only the, you know, looking for funding, but it's also to look for the education, the communication, the ability to understand what's going on. So that if you're running a shelter, that's very, very difficult business. Anybody running a shelter will tell you that it's such a difficult animal. And so do you have time in your day to understand what are the cause and effects, why these people are needing a shelter, you know, why do each individual at the shelter need to be treated a little bit differently, why is it so difficult to live in a shelter, right? So our responsibilities and are varied, but you know, it's all centered around trying to bring enough resources that we keep homelessness to a brief and non-recurring situation, if at all possible. Are we going to end it? I would love to say we can end it, but I want to be truthful that it's the fight is a long fight.
It is a long fight, and it's a constant fight, but. If you could, without using names, could you just give an overview of some of your success stories, some of the people that you've helped that you like to talk about it. It makes it all worthwhile what you do.
Yeah, you know, we've got a great team at the coalition, and they fight this, you know, this situation, the homeless situation. They and sometimes fight it one on one because we've had to be in some of the direct services areas, even though we didn't necessarily intend or want to be in it. So we've had a homeless veteran that came in with a family of six and came living in a really, really dangerous situation in a one room, and in that one room you and I probably wouldn't put our animals in that one room, and now he's in a permanent house, gone to college. This year we'll be graduating from Albright, and we expect that next fall, this coming fall, he'll be a teacher in Berks County. We've had a homeless veteran woman come to it, fleeing domestic violence, and with four children, and was fearful of any place where that possible be victimized again.
Right.
So, you know, that trauma can only be cured with time. The trauma can only be cured with a long-standing support and case management, and whether or not they're not fearing that they're going to lose that permanent supportive housing solution that you gave them. And that's what the government is looking for, is as well as possible. If there was enough affordable housing to put people in. We've had an individual, a young woman with two children, came to us, and we had private funding that was able to, she was working, she could go to work, she could afford her rent, but her car broke down. She could not afford the car repairs. And once that car broke down, and now the job stopped, and the income stopped, and the utilities couldn't get paid, the rent couldn't get paid, and it was all centered around that vehicle. Well, thank God we had private funding that was able to fix that car, and then it was like the switch went back on. She went back to work, the income came back on, the rent got paid, the arrangements with the utility companies were rectified with a budget, and that course which was going towards homelessness was averted. I wish we could say we could do that for every single situation. I wish we could say we could do it through all the different organizations, and there are some great organizations in Berks County that fight homelessness with us, our partner agencies. At the end of the day, you have to rely on those success stories to get you to ready to put on the boxing gloves and go fight in the morning.
See, that's great. I would love to have more time to talk to you just about those success stories. This has been a super informative session here today, and I hope everybody learned a little bit more about the problem that we have. And if people are interested and want to help, how can they get involved?
Check our website. You can communicate via email. You can check our Facebook page, Berks Coalition and Homelessness. Any different way. If they want to volunteer, if they want to donate, if they want to donate supplies that we distribute to homeless individuals. I mean, the website is the key. It will give you all the different avenues, and obviously it has our phone number and our contact information right on there.
Fantastic. Jack, thank you very much for coming here today, and thank you all for joining us.